Good morning and welcome to the first meeting of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee in 2022. I would ask all members and witnesses to ensure their mobile phones are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. Our first item this morning is consideration of whether to take items 3 and 4 in private. Item 3 will be an opportunity for members to consider the evidence they have heard this morning as part of its budget scrutiny for 2022 to 23. Item 4 will be a chance for the committee to consider its report to Parliament on the short-term lets regulations, which the committee previously agreed to approve. Do members agree to take items 3 and 4 in private? And that's everyone agreed. Thank you. The second item on our agenda today is to take evidence as part of the committee's budget scrutiny. The committee will be taking evidence from the 3 panels this morning. Firstly, the committee will be hearing from Unison, then Solis and COSLA, and finally the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy and the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government. And I would like to firstly welcome to the committee Joanna Baxter, who's the head of local government at Unison. Thank you, Joanna, for joining us today. We're going to move straight to questions, and I'd like to begin by asking whether Unison has conducted analysis on the impact the 2022 to 23 budget may have had on their members and the individuals and communities that they serve.
We regularly survey our branches across Scotland to determine the impact of the local government settlement on members and the services that they provide. Feedback that we have received today demonstrates that the proposed budget for local government in 22-23 is wholly inadequate for the challenges faced by members working in local government. It doesn't take into account rising inflation. It doesn't take into account demographic changes, the last decade of austerity, the huge number of local government jobs that have been lost in that time, and a number of outstanding commitments that COSLA have to honour to the local government workforce, not least of which one is fully consolidating the living wage across all local authorities in Scotland. And that hasn't happened in every local authority area yet, despite there being a commitment to have done so by the 1st of April last year. And fundamentally, the proposed budget allocation doesn't take into account a decent pay rise for local government workers who have been central to the pandemic response alongside their colleagues working in health. I would just say that whilst industrial action was narrowly avoided in the last pay negotiations, I think the strength of feeling the Unison members demonstrated in the numerous ballots that we had to hold last year during the conduct of those negotiations demonstrates that there is a huge amount of anger and frustration amongst the workforce about the lack of recognition they've had for the contribution they've made to the pandemic response.
Thank you for that, for your thoughts on that. Follow-up question. Does Unison believe additional council tax raising powers will help local authorities alleviate budgetary pressures? And more broadly, Unison believe council tax is actually fit for purpose?
Well, I think we know that council tax hits those on the lowest incomes hardest. So I think that's a point that's been recognised by political parties across the political spectrum, given the numerous commitments that have been made to replace the council tax. What I would say is that I don't believe that low-paid local government workers should have to pay for their own salary increase through their council tax. The numerous disputes that we've had, both with COSLA and the Scottish Government, is that when we go to COSLA seeking a decent pay rise for our members, they say they don't have adequate funding or flexibility in their funding from the Scottish Government to enable them to fund that. When we take the argument to the Scottish Government to suggest that they should give local government the funding and flexibility to fund that, they say local government pay has nothing to do with us, it's a matter for COSLA. Fundamentally, Unison believes that no longer should it be the case that our members are used as a political football between COSLA and the Scottish Government. I don't believe that this situation will be resolved by hiking up council tax across Scotland, which will disproportionately hit those on lowest incomes hardest, and will likely hit those poorer areas of Scotland hardest, because they will be in more dire need to raise funds because of the demographic pressures and inflationary pressures on their services. So I don't think that's a reasonable proposal to resolve this issue. What the Scottish Government needs to do is fully fund a decent public sector pay uplift for local government workers, and to ensure that there is adequate flexibility within the core funding of local authorities to ensure that that money is passed on.
Thank you very much for your perspective on that. I'm going to move on and to questions and then from Paul McClellan.
Good morning, John. Can I refer everyone to my register of interests? I'm a Devon councillor on East Lothian Council at the moment. John, just really to ask, obviously within the block grant, we have to spend, you know, there's a limited amount of what we can do in terms of spend. There's more money to go to local government. In your own view, where should Scottish Government take this money from? What other part of the Scottish budget should it take it from, in your opinion?
That's not for Unison to say. I mean, obviously, we're not in the position that the Scottish Government is in relation to looking at the budget pressures across all service areas. What I would say is that there has been an uplift to the Scottish Government's block grant from Westminster, and I would suggest it would not be unreasonable to ensure that some of that increase was passed on to local government. That has not been the case for many years. So whilst it's not for us to say where else in the Scottish Government the money should be taken from, what we would say is that there does appear to be money in the system. And one thing that the Scottish Government could do is take the hand chains off local government and allow them to the flexibility to spend their core budget for the areas that they believe are particularly pressured in their local areas.
Yeah, I know there'll be questions. I know colleagues will be asking questions on ring fencing later on, so I'll leave it to them to talk about that. And because obviously I know you head of local government, with Unison. I know it's not just local government you represent. There's other parts, obviously, within the Scottish economy, if you like, that you'll do that. So you know that, hence the reason why I asked that particular question. Just a little bit of supplementary, and that obviously is on being a councillor and have been for the last 15 years. We know there's additional pressures in terms of COVID, and the consequentials for that did come through last year, but not this year. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that regard, because I know that's been raised with UK government in terms of the COVID consequentials coming through. They're not coming through this year. However, there are obviously, as we know, still pressures on local authorities to deliver services impacted by COVID. I don't know if you have any thoughts on that aspect at all.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a continuing need for additional funding to respond to the COVID crisis, because it's quite clear that that crisis is not yet over. And certainly what we have seen is Unison members across Scotland have stepped up to the plate in terms of responding to that crisis. If we look at, residential and care workers, school support staff, cleaners in schools, environmental health officers who set up temporary mortuaries, the distribution of business support grants, all of those critical services depend on Unison members working in local authority areas. It's quite clear that local government will continue to be critical to the pandemic response. The need for additional cleaning in schools is not going to go away. The need for continued support for businesses is not going to go away. The continued pressure on social care workers is not going to go away anytime soon. And the continued pressures in schools in terms of the catch-up on the education for children in Scotland is not something that's going to be resolved anytime soon. So those pressures remain. The need for additional funding to resource those remains. And I think one thing that we did see during the pandemic was a rush to find additional resources and support and recruitment in areas that have been hard hit by austerity over the last decade. So if you take cleaners in schools as an example, we saw early on in the pandemic a rush to recruitment for cleaners in schools. And why was that? Because there was not enough of them, because that's a service area that had been cut due to local government funding cuts over the past 10 years. We cannot allow ourselves to get into that position again. So there's a continual need for resourcing in those service areas, and that's not going to go away anytime soon. I think the other thing the committee needs to consider in this, though, is the fact that the world of work is also going to be changing. So, and local government is not immune to that either. So we conducted a survey of our members last year on the impact of working in the pandemic. And the number of those that had adapted their working environments to the pandemic, working from home, the number who had seen increases in workload were all significant. I'm very happy to share that survey with you. It received more than 12,000 responses from workers across Scotland. And it's quite clear that if those sorts of arrangements are going to continue going forward, working from home, for example, they are going to have to be funded. We cannot be in a position where low-paid local government workers are having to finance increases in their fuel bills in order to facilitate home working caused by a pandemic that had nothing to do with them.
Yeah. Joanna, thanks for that. I'll be very brief as well. Have Unison contacted UK government in terms of the consequentials coming through at all? And the second question I was going to ask, and you've already touched on this, was in terms of local government role in helping local communities. You've already touched on it. If there was anything else you wanted to add on to that, but the first one really, as I said, is have you contacted UK government in terms of consequentials coming through to obviously to Scottish government, and then coming down to local authorities?
So our colleagues in Unison head office are in regular dialogue with the UK government, particularly about local government funding and consequentials. So yes, is the answer to that. In relation to
Joanna, sorry, just to interrupt. Have you heard anything back? Have you heard anything back in that regard as of yet, in terms of the consequentials?
No. I haven't had anything specific on that. Right. No.
Okay. Thanks. And sorry, the second bit was on. If you wanted to add anything else in terms of what else could local government do in helping local communities and economies recover from the pandemic, you've already touched on what they're already doing. But if there's anything else you wanted to add.
Yes, I mean, obviously, there needs to be investment. I think there needs to be a whole system approach and thinking about health and well-being in our communities, and also education. Education is not just about teachers in schools. It's about the whole support system that exists within schools and also out with schools. I'll give you one example. Cuts in recent years, you will have seen youth centres like Kilbowie closed. That's a direct result of cuts to local government funding. And I think, you know, people who use that service would be the first to tell you that a service like that is really vital to the development for our children and young people. It's those sorts of services that are perhaps not immediately visible to the public that have been at the sharp end of cuts in recent years. And to be honest, if the Scottish Government only focuses on the role of teachers in schools, They are not giving consideration to the whole support system that is in place or should be in place for children's development in Scotland. Outdoor education centres, after school activities, etc. And in terms of health and wellbeing, we need to view these as community services, which link together with other community services like housing, education, leisure, culture, community organisations, families and neighbours. We start moving away from that at our peril because we start then breaking down communities. So we believe that those services are local services. They should be delivered as locally as possible. And so there needs to be investment in those. And we need to take whole system thinking specifically about education and health and wellbeing.
Joanna, thank you.
Thanks very much for that. We're now going to move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ms. Baxter. Thanks for joining us this morning. You said earlier, and also unison in the previous committee outlined cuts to staffing and increased workloads. Now, some of the figures which we've been given as a committee suggests that since 2015, we've seen a 2% higher employment level. So I wondered, in terms of workload, we all know, certainly I know here in Edinburgh, the lack of social care staff. So I just wondered where that employment figure had come from and where necessarily you've seen the loss of different members.
Yes, so we've done a number of different surveys of members and across local authorities in Scotland. Certainly, one example I would give is one that I referred to earlier in relation to cleaning staff, for example, in schools. So we might have seen now those numbers increase, but that's directly as a result of the needs of the pandemic and the resourcing that came with that. But library service staff have received cuts. Planning departments have received cuts. HR departments have received cuts. Really all non-statutory services have been impacted by cuts to local authority funding over the last decade. And I think also, you know, there's particular concerns in relation to leisure and culture services, who obviously many of which are arm's length external organisations of local authorities, but principally rely on funding from those local authorities. In relation to leisure and culture staff, if you look at their contribution to the pandemic, they have been redeployed to staff testing centres and vaccination centres to deliver food parcels across local authority areas. So all of those workers have contributed to that pandemic response in one way or the other.
Thank you for that. SNP and Green ministers have said that this budget will reduce inequalities. Now, what would your opinion be on that, given that we know that there's £371 million of cuts attached to this budget?
I think it's highly unlikely that this budget will reduce inequalities, particularly if we see council tax increased across Scotland as a result of it. Because as I said earlier, council tax disproportionately impacts those on lowest wages and will likely be used by those authorities who have been hardest hit by local government funding cuts. Additionally, taking away some of the education support grants is not going to, the PEF funding is not going to reduce inequalities. And I think the very fact that the budget doesn't take into account demographic changes or inflationary pressures means that those issues will remain and the cuts will disproportionately impact on those particular authorities that have higher demographic and inflationary pressures.
That's helpful, thank you. In the submission to the committee, Unison said that you would support ring fencing in some budget areas. And I just wondered, in terms of a degree of ring fencing which you'd see as necessary? Which areas do you think that should be attached to for budgeting, given these pressures which local authorities are seeing?
Well, the Scottish Government and COSLA consistently say that those ring-fenced areas are for Scottish Government priorities, which would beg the question to us why an inflationary increase for local government workers is not a Scottish Government priority. So certainly we would expect that a fully funded increase for local government workers should be built into that budget. But I think there does need to be greater flexibility for local authorities in terms of the amount of control they have over their local budgets. If you look at North Ayrshire's budget, for example, 80% of their budget is controlled by the Scottish Government, which gives them very little flexibility at all over the money they've got to spend. So I think there's got to be a balance. But I would say, particularly in the year ahead, there needs to be a fully funded amount for an inflationary uplift for local government workers.
Thank you. And finally, I wanted to ask a question with regards to the National Care Service. That's something which ministers say they'll bring forward this year in terms of a bill and what that will look like. I think a number of people have expressed concerns, including COSLA and others. So I just wondered what Unison's view is on that and what impact you think that could have on members and the recruitment crisis, which you've kind of outlined already around social care.
Well, that's a big question. we probably don't have enough time to cover that in the sort of detail that it deserves. But what I would say is Unison submitted a very detailed response to the national consultation on the National Care Service. So I would refer you to that for all the detailed comments. What I would say is that I think the case needs to be made as to why there needs to be greater centralisation of those services. As I've said earlier, our belief is that social care is a community service best delivered in the community, with the aim of supporting individuals to continue living in the community, and it needs to be joined up with other local community services. So that's one thing. I mean, the other thing that I would say is that the proposed centralisation is likely to require significant resources, time and capacity from local authorities to try to deliver that at a time in which the pressure on them caused by the pandemic remains, is not going away, and will require significant financial investment from the Scottish Government, which does not appear to be coming anytime soon.
Thanks very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Miles. And now we're going to move to questions from Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to you, Ms. Baxter. Before I start, just to refer everyone to my register of interests, I am still a serving councillor at East Ayrshire Council. So the first question I have this morning for you relates to the fact that Unison recently called on the Scottish Government to introduce incentives in the 2022-23 budget to attract more people to work in the care sector and encourage social care workers to stay. So I wonder whether Unison welcomes the £233.5 million in this year's budget help ensure that the living wage is paid to those care workers? And should this money be ring-fenced for the stated purposes?
So I think we always welcome additional investment. I don't believe that it goes far enough and is not reaching those workers quickly enough in order to address the significant recruitment pressures that exist at the moment. I think we do need to look at how we deliver fair work across that sector. And obviously that's something that goes beyond workers in social care who are working for local authorities, but also in terms of the third and private sector. And as I said to your colleague, we obviously submitted a very detailed response on the proposed National Care Service to the Scottish Government, and there are very detailed submissions within that about how we can best ensure fair work is delivered across that sector.
Thank you for that. I do have another question in relation to the assertion that you have about the fact that this year that the Scottish Block Grant has been significantly increased. I mean, David Iser of the Fraser of Allender Institute observed recently that next year's Scottish Block Grant is, quote, not really very generous at all. Do you agree that once non-recurring COVID consequentials, the monies are stripped out, Scotland's resource budget is being cut by 7.1% in real terms and the capital budget by 9.7% in real terms? And this actually, in effect, gives rise to a very difficult budget situation and presented to the Scottish Government. And therefore, the uplift of 5% to local government is as fair as it possibly can be. So just to come back on the fact that you asserted that this was a real terms increase to the Scottish Government's budget from Westminster.
So obviously I'm not here to answer for the Westminster government, but what I would say is that there are a number of different publications which refer to the increase in the Scottish Block Grant from Westminster. And of course, there was recent announcements in terms of additional funding for devolved administrations to assist with the COVID recovery as well. I mean, my general point is that increases to the Scottish Block Grant do not get passed on to local government. They may be passed on to other service areas, but they do not get passed on in the terms of percentage increases that the Scottish Government gets from Westminster. I don't believe that the budget for Scottish local government is as fair as it could be. And I think you would struggle to find members of local authorities who believe that. Certainly 32 local authority leaders writing to the First Minister requesting a meeting to discuss their concerns about the Scottish budget allocation would suggest that they don't believe that it is as fair as it could be. And I think the very fact that local government did not even receive a mention by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance in the budget statement demonstrates to everybody the priorities in relation to local government that the Scottish Government appear to have. So I think a lot more needs to be done. Local government is in crisis at the moment. The local government workforce are on their knees, and we are entering a set of pay negotiations which I have to say, given the Scottish budget allocation to local authorities, will be extremely challenging. And given the level of anger our members expressed in relation to the conduct of negotiations last year, I cannot see a situation where that anger does not feed into this year's negotiations. And I would suggest that if an inflationary increase for local government workers is not delivered in those negotiations, we are going to see an extremely challenging industrial landscape in local government.
From myself, in relation to all that you've just said, how would Unison respond to the fact that local government reserves have increased by approximately £300 million over the course of the pandemic?
Well, reserves cannot be spent on many of the budget areas that local authorities need to spend money on. I think Ms Forbes would deliver exactly the same answer to us if we asked her about the Scottish Government's reserves, which have also increased. So I don't think that is a valid argument. Reserves are tied up in a number of areas and are no simple solution to the problems that local authorities face and couldn't, for example, be used on pay.
That's all from me, Ariane. Back to yourself.
Thank you, Eleanor. I'm just going to come in with a quick question, Joanna. So heads of Planning Scotland and the Royal Town Planning Institute Scotland raised concern when the budget was published that a long-term challenge lies ahead for planning. And it's the most heavily cut public service sector since 2009. And has an overwhelmingly older workforce with only 9% of planners under 30. In this light, I'd like to ask for your views on how well budgets recognise staffing challenges for local authority departments such as planning.
I don't think they do take account of some of those staffing challenges. As I cited earlier, it is those sort of non-statutory services which have seen some of the biggest cuts to funding over the past decade. So it is no surprise to me that there is a recruitment crisis within planning, but that's certainly not the only service area within local authorities which have a recruitment crisis. As I was saying earlier, in terms of some of the other cuts that we've seen, youth work services in some local authority areas don't exist anymore. There are certainly recruitment crises within waste services, for example. Early years and home support, social care workers, there are massive pressures in recruitment in those areas. And I think a lot of this does go back to funding and pay, because if we want to attract people to these critical roles, and they are critical, then we need to pay them appropriately. These are not low-skilled roles. They are high-skilled roles, which happen to be low-paid. 55% of the local government workforce earn below £25,000 a year. Those are not high salaries. And when we live in a society where someone who is currently a social care worker could leave their job and go over to McDonald's and earn more per hour working there than they could in their social care role, then you really have to ask the question about where the priorities lie in society. We need to invest in all of those critical roles, and that requires money for pay. And if I could just very briefly touch back on this point about the forthcoming pay round, my concern is that we will be back in exactly the same position with COSLA and the Scottish Government on pay this year in just the next couple of months as where we were at the end of last year. The Scottish Government and COSLA only narrowly avoided mass industrial action in local government last year. If an inflationary increase does not transpire for local government workers this year, I fear we will not narrowly avoid that this year, but in fact, we'll see a very difficult industrial landscape ahead.
Thank you, Joanna, for your response. I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin now. I think he has a question.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Ms. Baxter. Just wanted to come back to the issue around local government staff pay, morale, and the ability that we'll have to deliver services. Now, the Cabinet Secretary has said that the local government core budget is being protected in cash terms. Now, with inflation and demographic pressures, that means a significant cut, as we all know. But how would your members react to being told that their wages were going to be protected in cash terms this year, with inflation running as it is?
Well, I don't believe that would be welcomed, which is why I've referred to, I think, the very difficult industrial landscape that we are facing in the year ahead. And let me cite a couple of examples. So we've talked about a number of different service areas where local government workers have responded fantastically to the COVID pandemic. What they have seen, however, is that while some workers have been rewarded for their contribution, the vast majority of local government workers have not. So I was on a call yesterday with a head of HR for one local authority. They've had a request from their local NHS boards to provide cleaning staff to go into hospitals and clean in high dependency wards. So these are local government workers not used to working in a medical setting, not trained in working in a medical setting, and not deemed exceptional by the Scottish Government or essential for the purposes of the £500 COVID reward payments. And yet they are being asked to undertake some of the most high risk procedures in relation to supporting the pandemic response. Quite frankly, our members feel like they have been completely forgotten by the Scottish Government in terms of their flexibility, their commitment and their professionalism during the pandemic period. I would refer again to the survey that we conducted of our members last year on working under pandemic conditions, and the impact of this pandemic on local government workers has been extreme. We had 27% of members tell us that they'd had the effect of the last year had had such an impact on their mental health that they'd had to seek medical assistance. So that is not just a workforce that is slightly stretched or a bit tired. That's almost a third of respondents telling us that they had had to have medical intervention to assess their mental health as a result of the pressure caused by this pandemic. And whilst other services, which are more visible, people in uniforms might have had recognition for their efforts, much of the support that local government workers have been provided has gone unnoticed and unrecognised. And I would say we are at a point where our members are on their knees and they require and deserve an inflationary increase to their pay this year. And as I said, I think the anger and frustration that they experience at the moment for their lack of recognition means that if that is not forthcoming in the next pay negotiations, which are going to start very soon, then we will be in an extremely difficult industrial landscape.
Thanks. And just touching on that industrial landscape like you talked about, now clearly local government workers have performed heroically through the pandemic and still do. What will be the situation for public services in Scotland if a flat cash award to local government staff is made? How do you think that is going to impact on local government provided services that we are still relying on, we have always relied on, but even to a great extent to the pandemic? How will that impact on those services in the coming year if a flat cash fee award is made?
Well, it depends what the flat cash award is. if it meets inflationary pressures, then we might avert it. But I very much doubt that that will be the case. If we don't receive an inflationary increase for members, then I suspect that they would vote to take some form of action to secure a better offer. Now, clearly, we are a member-led organisation. It will be for members to decide in our consultative ballots whether they accept or reject an offer. But what I would say and what I see every day is the level of anger and frustration amongst our members at the lack of recognition of their efforts, at the lack of recognition of the pressures they've experienced from the decade of underfunding to local government. And the fact that they are absolutely exhausted, and it's one thing asking people to go the extra mile during the period of a pandemic, to keep going the extra mile, but to not reward them when they do so, I think builds up a level of anger which is not easily dissipated. So I think what our members demonstrated last year in the ballots that we conducted is that they are prepared to take action. In the statutory industrial action ballots that the three Scottish Drawing Council trade unions ran, we had mixed results across the country, but we had the capacity to deliver amongst the three trade unions disruption to services in half of local authority areas. We took a decision to target those ballots at select groups, and I think the level of anger that was shown in those ballots demonstrated that if they were to be balloted again anytime soon, it is very likely they would vote in a very similar way. So I would urge COSLA and the Scottish Government to bang heads together and ensure that when the trade union, the joint trade union pay claim is submitted, that it delivers an inflationary increase for our members working in local government, and recognises the significant and heroic efforts that they have made during the period of this pandemic.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you, Mark. And I'm going to move to a final question from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to our colleague from Unison. I just wanted to go back to the settlement that was discussed earlier, if I can, Joanna. Do you accept, as in the spice papers that we've received for the committee, that the overall total settlement for local government is actually up? It's a real terms increase of £603 million, or equivalent to a 5.1% uplift. That's in the spice papers, which, as we all know, are independent of government. So does Unison accept that, so that we can clarify whether we're talking about cuts or whether we're talking about uplifts?
So the budget settlement does not include or account for inflation or demographic changes. It, saying that local government gets more money, but that the Scottish Government has ring-fenced more of it for their own priorities, doesn't deliver, I think, the funding, the flexibility that local authorities need to respond to the significant pandemic pressures, demographic pressures, or inflationary pressures that they face. Particularly in relation to inflation, as I said earlier, not accounting for an inflationary uplift for local government workers in pay negotiations, I think, is not adequate.
But they agree that an additional real terms increase of £603 million is on the table, and that is a 5% uplift. You might say it's not enough, of course, but do you agree that these are the correct figures?
Well, the Scottish Government have told COSLA how they will be spending most of their money. As I cited earlier, in North Ayrshire, for example, 80% of their budget is determined by the Scottish Government. So they do not control 80% of the spending that they are allocated. So whilst there may be uplifts, it is for specific priorities determined by the Scottish Government, and is not a real terms uplift, given that it does not account for inflation.
Okay, let's just leave that question there, I think. It was interesting earlier to hear you agreeing with the Conservative member of the committee about the impact of the budget on poverty and inequality. You must surely be aware that the Scottish Government spends £594 million mitigating mitigating the effects of cuts imposed by the United Kingdom government. And one of the standout items in there is discretionary housing payments, where £83 million is still spent by the Scottish government that would hitherto have been cut by the UK government. Do you recognise that that continuing investment by the Scottish government does make a significant impact in reducing poverty and inequality in Scotland?
Well, I've seen no paper on the impact of discretionary housing payments on inequalities. What I would say is that cutting PEF funding will not alleviate inequalities in some of the poorer areas of Scotland. So, I mean, we can pick figures from different parts of the budget, but I would suggest that a real terms cut to local government funding, with local authorities' only option but to increase the council tax to try to alleviate some of that, will disproportionately hit those on lowest incomes hardest. So I don't see that this budget will reduce inequalities, quite the opposite.
I mean, it's quite a substantial cherry pick, though. It's £594 million that would otherwise not be spent. And some of that money is targeted towards the most poorest and most vulnerable people that we have in Scotland, Joanna. So does Unison not recognise that that is a worthwhile investment by the Scottish Government to continue to do that, to try and alleviate the worst impacts brought about by decisions taken by the UK Government?
So I'm not going to comment on every single aspect of the Scottish Government's budget allocations, because many services are worthwhile for additional investment. I would suggest, however, that the totality of the budget allocation to local authorities will do nothing to reduce the inequalities that local communities will be experiencing in Scotland. I'm not going to get into disputes between the Scottish Government and the Westminster Government. That's not for us to determine. I would simply cite yet again the fact that there have been increases to the Scottish Government's block grant, which have not translated to local government. And that is an issue that needs to be addressed, in our view.
Okay, great. Thanks very much for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Willie. And thank you, Joanna, for joining us this morning. I think that's come to the end of our questions. So, yeah, thanks for being with us today. Your responses have been very helpful. And I'm now going to suspend to allow a changeover of witnesses.
Thank you.
Welcome back. We continue taking evidence as part of our budget scrutiny, and I'd like to welcome our second panel this morning, Councillor Gail McGregor, who's the resource spokesperson for COSLA, Eileen Rowland, who's the executive director of Finance and Corporate Services of Fife Council, and Martin Booth, who's the executive director of Finance for Glasgow City Council, representing Solus. Thanks for joining us today. We're going to move straight to questions, and witnesses, if you wish to respond or contribute to the discussion, please add an R to the chat box to indicate this. And we tend to try to direct our questions to specific people. So I'm going to start, and this question I'm going to direct to Eileen, but as I said, anyone is welcome to also come in on this. Eileen, what are COSLA's views on the real term cuts to core revenue funding in 2022-23, and what impact this could have on the services, communities and employees?
Thanks for bringing me in on this. So I think from the SPICE briefing that was issued last week, and also the budget reality that's came from COSLA, we are in agreement that there is flat cash settlement, but once we take into account national insurance and council tax reduction increases, we are seeing pressures of £100 million. Now, for a number of years, local government have had broadly flat cash settlements. If I look at my own council over the last 4 years, that's what the average is. And what that has meant is that we've had to deliver significant savings in order to fund inflation and meet demographic growth. And we're now at a tipping point whereby the sustainability of local government is really in question. And I suppose when I look forward to the next 2 years after this budget settlement, I'm really concerned about the sustainability of local government. And I think we've got to be clear about what local government's role can be going forward with the level of funding that will come from the UK to the Scottish Government and then to councils. And probably my plea would be to look at the role that local government play in improving health and wellbeing. And there's a level of protection that's given to the health service. Obviously, NHS boards are receiving a 2% increase, where councils are receiving flat cash. The last thing I would point out is that the level of new commitments, new burdens that are coming to councils, they're good things, but they really are at the expense of core services such as roads and transports and bins and libraries. So it is a very precarious position for local government.
Thank you for that response, Eileen. I've got a question now that I'd like to direct to Councillor Gail McGregor. Considering the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy said she did not recognise some of the figures used by COSLA in response to the Finance and Public Administration Committee, can you firstly give your views on this yearly recurring debate between COSLA and the Scottish Government? And secondly, could you suggest potential solutions to encourage cooperation between the two? And that's for Councillor Gail McGregor.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, members. We do seem to have a bit of a to and fro every single year. I've been doing this for 5 years now, and we don't always agree on the figures. I think the discrepancies come when we begin to weed out the ring fence pots of funding and how much is notionally ring fence or absolutely directed to Scottish Government policy. So if we look back to last year, for instance, 58% of the budget was absolutely directed to individual policy pots that were part of Scottish Government policy. That's actually risen to 62% this year. So we're not disputing that there's more money in local government's budget, absolutely not a dispute. And I did watch Joanna's submissions earlier on in and around that additionality and how it's been presented. The difficulty occurs when you begin to look at what that money is for. So at the moment, as Eileen said, we have £100 million decrease to our budget. We absolutely know that that's fact through national insurance and the council tax adjustment. When we begin to factor in the £800 million worth of ring-fenced policy commitments of Scottish Government, which we have to deliver, some of those were signed up to do, others they're slightly more imposed upon us. So I suppose that the difficulty will come in trying to establish better partnership working with government. I think what we need to do, and Ms Forbes and I think really need to concentrate on, is the development of policies rather than Scottish Government announcing a policy and announcing a fixed pot of money associated to that policy. It would be far better if there was better consultation with local government through COSLA and our member councils to ensure that whichever policy Scottish Government has announced and wants to deliver is absolutely fit for purpose. And I'll take free school meals as an example. There was a commitment within the 100 days and within the manifesto that there would be a rollout of free school meals across primary. There was an unrealistic expectation as to how councils could deliver that, and there was an unrealistic pot of funding put to, towards that. So they're now having to rail back from that, and I think it's really important as we go forward that when we develop really crucial policies that can help inequalities within our communities, that we do it in partnership, and then we make sure that we get the absolute best policy that will deliver the best outcome for our communities. So I think that would probably be my plea to government, that if we do have to continue with these ring fence pots, which, believe me, leaders do not like because they like local autonomy, and we'll maybe move on to that in another part of the session, that if we can co-construct these policies, we will end up with better outcomes.
Great, thank you very much for that. I'm going to move on to a question from my colleague Megan Gallagher.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panellists. Before I ask my questions this morning, I'd like to draw members to my register of interests, as I am a serving councillor on North Lanarkshire Council. COSLA released a statement that heavily criticised the government as councils face a real terms reduction in funding of £284 million this year. And I'd like to ask Gail first, please, is COSLA concerned that some councils may have to increase council tax significantly to offset the cuts administered by the Scottish Government? And what impact does COSLA feel that this will have on taxpayers, particularly people impacted by the pandemic and struggling to make ends meet?
Thank you, Megan, and good morning. I've never seen leaders as angry as they were at our special leaders meeting when we were going through the figures for the settlement and obviously the relaxation around council tax. It was unanimous. Every council leader of all political persuasions were really deeply disappointed in this settlement because, as I say, when we factor in all the additional ring-fenced pressures that we're going to have to deal with, it makes it a very challenging landscape. And I think the anger was even more that the Scottish Government have the ability to raise income tax themselves and chose not to. And what they've essentially done is pass the buck to local government to fill that funding gap because there wasn't sufficient funding within the block grant and within the settlement. So I think there's a real anger there amongst leaders that the pressure is now being put on them to make very difficult decisions locally. And I know that you'll know that better than most. I don't see an appetite from leaders to hit households any more than is absolutely necessary. I think leaders and councillors across Scotland understand the pressures that households are currently under. An above the inflationary rise in council tax would be seen as very unpalatable. So I suspect that we will be seeing around about an inflationary mark of maybe 3%, which we've had in recent years. But as I say, that the anger is there, that gap is needing to be filled by us making tough decisions rather than Scottish Government. So, the impact going forward in respect of economic development and recovery out of COVID is going to be even more challenging, given that we already have a reduction of circa £371 million within our settlement. We're expected to continue to do what we're doing. We're expected to continue to deliver on Scottish Government current priorities and new priorities. And we're also expected to look at pay aspiration as well. We've already heard within the budget that there's an aspiration now of £10.50 for a living wage. That puts a real pressure on local government. And I have to say that going forward, coming through from councils now, that their budget reports are looking really, really challenging. So we want to deliver for our communities, but it's where we have to cut to continue doing the ring-fenced and the protected elements that's going to cause the difficulty.
Thank you, Gail. And I think Martin's looking to come in.
Hi, yes. Thanks for bringing me in there. Just to clarify, council tax counts for a relatively low percentage of council's income. In Glasgow, it's only about 14%. In other authorities, it might be as high as 19%. Still a relatively low percentage. So if council tax would have been used as the sole source to close any financial pressures, So for Glasgow, that would be in the 20% increases, which, as Ms Baxter pointed out earlier on, does impact on our more disproportionately on our poorest citizens. So it is a tool that will be used to help close a budget gap, but it is not a sole solution by any stretch of the imagination.
Thank you very much for that input there, Martin. If I could just ask one quick follow-up question, convener, and then if I could hand back to yourself. And it is in relation to the letter that council leaders wrote to the First Minister over the unacceptable cuts to local government funding. And I'm just wondering, has COSLA received any update from the Scottish Government regarding this meeting? Will a meeting take place? And if so, what are leaders hoping to achieve from that meeting? And if I could hear from Eileen or Gail, please, on that.
Eileen.
I'll hand over to Gail because she's best placed to answer this question.
Okay. Great.
Sorry, I was waiting for myself to come off mute. Yeah, we wrote to the First Minister on the 24th of December. We received a response yesterday. It wasn't directly sent to me, but it was sent to 32 council leaders. And the response came from Ms Forbes. My understanding at this point is that the First Minister is not willing to meet with council leaders. And obviously, we will pursue that.
Thank you. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. And now we're going to move to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I'd just like to ask the question I tried to ask the Unison representative earlier there on the total settlement, probably for Councillor McGregor, I think it would be best. Do you recognise the figures that we have for the committee in our spice papers, which are independent, Councillor McGregor, that show an increase to £12.5 billion in terms of a settlement, and that represents a real terms increase of £603 million, or 5.1%. Now, we can argue about whether it's enough and whether we could do more and need more, but do you at least recognise those independent figures as being accurate?
Thank you, Willie. My answer may surprise you. Yes, I do recognise them as being accurate, and I do recognise that in its totality there is more money coming to local government, but within that funding, a huge amount of that is going through local government rather than to, so we're merely a conduit in the delivery of some of those payments and some of those policies. So that the funding is not directly to local government, it is being wired through local government. Over and above that, as we've already stated, there's a huge amount of ring fence pot, which is for delivery of early learning and childcare. It's for expansion of free school meals. It's for music instruction. There's a plethora of things that we could list. And I think that the difficulty there is that a large amount of those policies were policies which councils were delivering on in the last 10 years. And due to budget cuts, councillors have had to make really difficult decisions at local level to perhaps take out music instruction or to impose charges on it. And further down the line, the government have ridden in on a white horse, essentially, and put funding towards that. And I think that that really undermines the role of local government, because we've had to make incredibly tough decisions over the years to protect social care or education or many other services at the expense of some things which are now being funded directly from government. And I think it's just taking away that local autonomy. An example I would give you is perhaps, I think Joanna Baxter mentioned it as well, funding towards teachers. Now, teachers have been relatively protected over the last 10 years with teacher numbers protected. So putting additionality in for teachers might be highly valuable in North Ayrshire, but in Borders, they may require social workers, or in Dumfries and Galloway, they may require investment in roads. And I think the key thing is that when we have these overarching ring fence pots or policies, they don't necessarily fit in individual councils. And really, our plea would be, if there is additional funding that can come to local government, give us the flexibility to spend it where it needs to be spent, whether that be on mental health or, you know, child support or whatever. So I think the difficulty is, it's not that we don't recognise that there's additionality in the system. Absolutely there is. But it's the restrictions and the protections that are put on that funding that makes it very difficult for local government, because within the core, we still have to deliver all the other things as well.
Mm-hmm. But let me thank you for that response, Gail. That's a very fair response you gave there to the overall figures in the settlement. They're in black and white. They're independently produced by Spice, so it's really appreciated to do that. See on this issue about ring fencing and amounts and so on, we heard Joanna saying that in North Ayrshire, 80% of their budget is controlled by the Scottish Government. And there's another piece of information we have in front of us today, that the Scottish Government say that 92% of funding to local government is controlled by the local council. So that's a huge difference there, isn't it? And in between there probably lies the truth. There's shared priorities all over the place in there. You mentioned it yourself there. Isn't it a little bit unfair for some representatives to say it's all dicked at by the Scottish Government when most of it is shared priority at the end of the day?
Yes. Again, I'm not going to disagree with you, Willie. There's an awful lot of what we do together, which is incredibly valuable, and early learning and childcare is a prime example of that. But within that, if we don't continue to maintain core budgets at the core, once that particular service becomes, I suppose, embedded within a council, it becomes part of the core. So you can continue to put the cherry on top of the cake, but if there's no cake left, there's nothing, there's not an awful lot there to support the cherries. But I think the difficulty is that we need to look at, we have ring fences, which is very much Scottish Government policy priorities, and that's determined by Scottish Government. As I said to the convener, we need to develop those in partnership to make sure that we get the best delivery of policy that we possibly can. We then have, I suppose, essentially statutory services, which we're obliged to do in a certain way. We have protected. There's an awful lot within there. So I think perhaps that's what Joanna Baxter was hinting towards, that the 80% is a larger thing than just ring fence. It takes in protected and statutory as well. Our modelling shows that, as I say, we've gone from 58% directed support, or directed services, to 62% this year. So it leaves only 38% of the budget, which can essentially sustain the cuts. We can't take cuts from the 62%. We can only take it from the 38%, which makes it a very difficult landscape.
OK. Right. Thanks very much for that. Thank you.
Thank you, Willie. We're now going to move to a question from Paul McClellan.
Good morning, panel. Really just wanted to focus on particularly about the COVID pressures at the moment. We've heard discussions in the debate, obviously, around about whether it's real terms increase or so on. But what we are in at the moment, this is probably a question to yourself, Gail, is in terms of, obviously, we have COVID pressures that are still there for all local authorities, and still the same for my own local authority. I asked the question of Unison, have they contacted UK Government in terms of the additional COVID consequentials, which were previously there but not in the budget this year? And I asked, I think, David Kennedy from COSLA around about this in the middle of December. Have COSLA written to the UK Government asking about COVID consequentials coming through this year, or additional funding from UK Government to Scottish Government in terms of that? Because the COVID pressures are still going to be there, certainly for this financial year and probably beyond that.
Thanks very much, Paul. We haven't directly written to government, UK government, in and around the COVID consequentials. I think we do recognise that there are ongoing pressures of COVID. Absolutely. Councils are dealing with that every single day in many, many ways. And I think our leisure and sports and culture facilities are a prime example. And Martin knows an awful lot about this, that we are seeing an ongoing loss of income in those areas. So that gap does need to be filled. What I would say is that every single time I've met with Ms. Forbes, and we do have a good relationship, I have offered to potentially do a joint submission to UK government and stand shoulder to shoulder in that respect. And I think it's incredibly important that we look to protect services in Scotland, whether they're delivered by local government or Scottish government. And I will continue to commit to that joint approach. As yet, Ms. Forbes has preferred to deal with Treasury on her own, and I totally respect that. But I do think it's important that local government and Scottish government do stand together where we feel there is a bit of a, a discrepancy around funding, because we do know that the COVID pressures are not going to go away anytime soon. So a good settlement for local government would be the ideal, but how we get there, the devil's always in the detail.
No, thanks, Gail. We can obviously ask the Cabinet Secretary about that. Have COSLA estimated
Yeah. We did meet with Michael Gove in December, myself and the presidential team. That was the first meeting that we'd had with him in respect of levelling up and the levelling up agenda. So we have passed that particular issue to him as well.
Okay. Just on that, in terms of the additional, obviously, COVID pressures, have COSLA estimated or asked local authorities for their estimate of additional costs that have come through? I know my own local authority in East Lothian have done that, and it's not the easiest piece of work to do. I appreciate that. Is there an approximate figure that COSLA have arrived to say, look, COVID pressures for the next year directly related to COVID are going to be X amount? Because again, if there's going to be an ask of UK government and consequentials coming through, what are we asking for, if you know what I mean?
Yeah. I think I might pass to Eileen and Martin because they've been directly involved in that data gathering.
Okay, thanks, Gail.
Eileen, if you'd like to come in now, that would be great.
Okay, thank you. So probably just to add some context, obviously at the end of the financial year in March 2021, there was a lot of money passed to local government from Scottish Government. And that was done, obviously, partly because there's a limit to the funding that Scottish Government can hold. So when councils closed their books last year, we carried forward around £700 million of COVID monies. Now, we anticipate that we'll have to use that over the next 2 years. So we've been working closely with our colleagues within councils to look at their estimates. So the COVID money won't be sufficient going forward, but for the coming year, I think we have plans in place, but there will be pressures that do come. And I think we do have to support the Scottish Government in ensuring that we do make cases for additional funding to come where it's required. So I know there's a lot of scrutiny of councils' reserves and why we're holding such an increased level, but it's partly because of a large part of it is because of COVID monies, which we'll no doubt need and more.
Sorry, just a supplementary, if that's okay, Convener. In terms of that, will there be? I know that analysis has gone on, and I think, as I said to Gail, that I know it's not the easiest piece of work to do. But will there be a stage, in the next month or two, that for example, COSLA will say we need an extra £200 million, £300 million to get us through there? Will there be that point where you can actually, work out approximately how much would be required from UK government to come down through consequentials and so on? And again, I think getting back to the point that Gail mentioned, obviously maybe then liaising with Scottish Government to ask the UK government on that. Will there be a point soon that we'll know an approximate figure that would be required? Because if we were talking about, we can talk around about the £371 million and that caused the seat. Now part of that might be through that, part of that, I mean, we can dispute that one way or another. But in terms of that, could the additional funding obviously help negate that figure that would come through?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the COVID monies will be used within this financial year. So we've been working with colleagues to see what will be carried forward into 22-23. So it's less than 40%, I would say. But we're certainly within my council, and I know from other colleagues as well, we are seeing the impact of the loss of income and additional costs. And certainly for leisure and the likes, we expect that to go on for 2-4 years. So I think once we get to the point whereby we need to make a call for additional monies, we will work closely with the Scottish Government. We've obviously been focusing on the current year and looking forward to next year, but it's really an exercise that's more medium term.
Okay, Eileen, thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you. And I see Martin would like to come in on this as well.
Thank you, Convener. And yes, as Eileen said there, it's very difficult to know what's going to happen in the future when we don't know what the future holds. I think our position probably before the turn of the year would be different from it is now, because we didn't know about Omicron in November. So that's changing all the time. But going forward, our lost income is probably the biggest challenge. Earlier on, when Ms Baxter was talking, some discussions around culture and leisure services and the amount of support that we've had to provide to our Culture and Leisure Trust to ensure that it's continued viability. And that isn't just going to be last year and this year. That's going to go on for several years, and it's until confidence is rebuilt into the public to return. So in Glasgow's position, Glasgow Life, which is the Culture and Leisure Trust in Glasgow, had direct earned income, i.e. excluding their contract from the council, of £38 million that fell off a cliff. It disappeared overnight, and we're anticipating that will take 4 or 5 years for that to recover to that level. That level of support going forward is really difficult, and I would imagine we won't have figures through yet, but the Omicron outbreak over the last few weeks will have set them back on that challenge. It's understanding that we don't actually know how much it is, because we don't know how long this is going to continue.
Thank you for that, Martin. And I think we're going to move to questions from Eleanor Whittam now.
Thank you very much, convener, and welcome to the panel this morning. I'm going to direct my first question to Gail from COSLA, if I can. Her Majesty's Treasury's own figures, as published in the Block Grant Transparency document, show that the Scottish Government's resource budget has been cut by £2.6 billion in real terms between 21-22 and 22-23, taken together with a real terms capital budget cut of 9.7%. Does COSLA agree that the Scottish Government budget position is actually really quite difficult, and that the focus must be on those shared priorities that we do share between local government and national government, such as lifting children out of poverty?
Thanks, Elena, and lovely to see you. I think it's a very difficult comparison, because comparing 2021-22 with all the additional COVID consequentials was a very large amount of money. And it's not what we need to be doing is comparing 2020-21 to 2022-23, and then I think we probably get a more accurate comparison. If we begin to compare last year's funding, it doesn't give an accurate picture. Now, we've already said that we will require additional COVID funding. We will need to have ongoing support through COVID. So if there's an argument to go to UK government to request additionality in that respect, I think we should absolutely be doing that. But I don't think comparing last year's budget to this year's budget is a true comparison. We're looking very much at pre-COVID figures and where we're at now, and not looking at the COVID in the middle. Obviously, we're still in the middle of the pandemic. So, as I say, additional support may be required in many areas going forward, and there will be additional pressures. But I think that the key thing is not to compare. What we tend to do is look for trends over a longer period of time, and our tables tend to sort of track back to 2013-14 to today. And I think that that gives a much more accurate comparison.
Thanks for that, Gail. And I'd like to actually ask a few questions round about the £1.3 billion that's going to be transferred to local government from other portfolios during 2022-23. I know that there's been a long-standing request that, you know, consequentials in terms of social care, as you know, some of that gets to local government as opposed to always going to health. My question really is surrounding, you know, is that money welcomed? What extent of it do you think is going to be ring-fenced? And is you know, is that the right thing to do? How does that work in practice if this is money that's coming from other portfolios into local government?
Yeah. Any money that's coming into local government is obviously welcomed, and as you'll know, we've been in ongoing discussions with the Cabinet Secretary for Health, as well as Ms Forbes and wider Cabinet. And I think certainly we need to continue to push that case for additionality to come from health into our IJBs and our local boards. Integration is absolutely key, and where we can deliver services and prevent people from ending up in acute care in hospital or supporting them to stay in their home will take a massive burden off health. So I think those discussions need to continue. As you know, we've always had additional support for real living wage in health and social care, and that's something that we've negotiated certainly over my tenure over the past 5 years and continue to do so. There's probably always going to be a need for some ring fencing in some areas where there's joint agreement and where there's joint priority commitments. But I think the key thing is to continue to look at how our communities can be supported locally within the context of council services, leisure, you know, parks, you know, our health and wellbeing agenda, and trying to keep those people from having to go into hospital in the first instance, which will, as I say, save the NHS a huge amount of money. I think Eileen could maybe come in at this point as well.
Yes, thanks, Gail. Obviously, there's the money that's coming from the other portfolios. The 1.367 million now. What I would say about that, that money's all committed for things we've got to deliver on, except for a small element of the money that we've got for the living wage. So the bulk of it is, as Gail has alluded to earlier, being kind of passported through councils to partnerships. There's also money in there for additional teachers and support staff, but the bulk of it is to deliver new things. So the money is welcome, but it doesn't help with our core underlying problem.
Thank you to that and for that addition there. I think that we could all agree that, you know, the things that we're seeking to do that are shared priorities are things that money is definitely well spent on and that will have a significant impact on communities. The final question that I have, again, is for Gail. So, you know, COSLA's blueprint for local government did call for the removal and council tax, so that is a truly local tax. I know that you've already touched on that. So moving on from that, my question is round about the fiscal framework. And I know this is something we've been waiting for a very long time, and that this is something that the Cabinet Secretary for Finance has alluded to will enable us to actually set, you know, multi-year settlements. So it's just to get a feeling from Gail and from COSLA's perspective on it, you know, lifting the council tax caps is something that was, you know, asked by COSLA. But going forward, how do you feel that negotiations for a fiscal framework is actually going to take us to the next level with that local flexibilities? Yeah. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Elena. It's a really important piece of work that we've been doing for the past couple of years. And obviously, it was put slightly in abeyance due to COVID, as many, many things are, not least of all the working group that was looking at a replacement for council tax. So absolutely, we're looking for local autonomy on tax raising powers, essentially, whether it be council tax, whether it be the transient visitor levy or workplace parking or the number of other things that we're looking at. Within that, we are now reinstigating the conversation with Scottish Government. We've had a working group within COSLA, which has been cross-party and a very useful working group, looking at ways that we can empower local government more. And we'll be reporting to leaders on that soon as well. And we obviously discuss that with Scottish Government all the time. The key thing for us is it kind of works in tandem, because obviously they're looking at a fiscal framework between UK Government and Scottish Government as well. And they're sort of looking at remodelling what they do. So I think they have to run in tandem. But the key principle for us, and I suspect the key principle for Scottish Government to UK Government, is more autonomy to decide how you either raise additional funding or how you spend that funding. So I think in a lot of ways we're very much on the same page. And as I say, going forward, we will sort of pick up those conversations now and hopefully run with them. Our key thing is that we need stability of budget. So where possible, if we can get 2 or 3 year budgets, that will assist us with pay negotiations. It will assist us with service delivery. We've been in a period for the past 10 years where year on year budget cuts, late budgets for whatever reason, be it UK Government or Scottish Government, have then meant late budgets for us, which have meant, you know, late decisions as to what services you're going to cut. And I think the key thing is, if we have longevity of budget and an understanding of a 2 or 3 year budget plan, that will enable us to invest far better, both in capital terms and revenue terms, and ensure that the services that we are delivering are absolutely sustainable. The other key point with that is that it gives a bit of stability to our third sector and our voluntary partners, who are absolutely invaluable in delivering services for us, usually on a commission basis. But again, with that uncertainty of budget, we've been unable to give them certainty of contract. So I think that if we can get into a pattern through UK Government settlements, Scottish Government settlement, where we see a 3 year plan and a 3 year budget, that will be immensely helpful.
Thank you very much for that, Gail. And I don't know if Eileen wants to come in on that or if that was from the last one.
That was from the last one.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. Back to yourself, convener.
Thank you, Elena. And now we're going to go to Miles Griffin for a question.
You're mixing us up, convener. It's Miles Briggs.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay. It's New Year. I'll let you go.
Mark Griffin. Sorry about that, Miles.
That's okay.
We're going to use Mark.
Thanks, convener. Just a quick question off the back of the evidence from Unison on the earlier panel. Clearly, Unison are making a case for an inflationary uplift for local government staff. And I just wanted to ask Councillor McGregor whether she feels that is going to be possible for an inflationary uplift for staff wages going to be. Can that offer be made within this budget settlement?
Thanks very much, Mark. And I did hear Joanna earlier on. I think, given the settlement that we've got, it's going to be very difficult to give or to make an offer at an inflationary level. We obviously haven't had the pay claims in from the unions yet, and we'll work very hard to try and deliver the absolute best pay offer that we can when those claims do come in. I think one difficulty that we've had, again, you know, in recent times, is public sector pay policy, and it's raised an aspiration within public sector as to where pay will be pegged. Local government isn't covered by public sector pay policy, so when they talk about it in Parliament, we're not actually included within that, so there's no additional funding that comes to us for that. But it immediately raises the aspiration that we will automatically match whatever that policy is. And as I said earlier on, the £10.50 aspiration is quite an ambitious one. It's one that's going to be very, very difficult to cover and fund through local government. Any additionality going to other areas of the public sector seem to be getting additional funding for that, but local government has had no additional funding for public pay. And I think it makes it very difficult for us going into these negotiations, because our staff have done an absolutely tremendous job over the past 2 years. They do anyway in an ordinary year, but the past 2 years they have been exceptional. And I think Joanna made the point that local government, they're not terribly well paid in the first instance compared to some other sectors or some other areas, and we maybe need to address that in the longer term. But it's going to be an incredibly challenging time to make a pay offer which respects and rewards our workforce when we don't get any additionality from Scottish Government to do that.
Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Mark. And I've got a final question. It's around the three island authorities, and I'm going to direct this to Gail. So given the unique pressures that the three island authorities face and complex services that they run with limited resources, for example, ferries, I'd like to ask for your views on the impact of the real terms reduction in their overall revenue allocations for next year.
Thanks very much, convener. I'll maybe pass to Eileen or Martin in a moment. The islands are incredibly challenging because, as you know, it costs more to live there than it does in the mainland. When you look at the statistics and the numbers on pieces of paper, that they're getting more per head of population. So it would appear on the surface that they're actually getting more than other areas, but whether that is sufficient to cover their budget pressures and the strains that are within these very rural, remote communities is a conversation I'll be having with James Stockin fairly soon, and we'll continue to have with island authorities. We want them to be as supported as possible. And certainly in previous budget rounds, additionality has gone to the islands. When we've had stages of budget, obviously we have a different situation now because we have a cooperation agreement between the SNP and Greens. But I'll work very hard with the island authorities to ensure that they feel as supported as possible. And if they require additional support to government, we'll give them that as well.
Thank you, Gail. And I see that Eileen would like to come in on this as well. And then we'll go to a few questions from Miles Briggs.
What I would say obviously there's a real term reduction for all councils, and I know that there have been concerns raised about the islands, but as Gail's outlined, they do receive the highest share when we look at the allocation per head, and it's quite considerable. Now, that's obviously because of the way that they have to deliver their services. If you look at the settlement that's came through, what I would say is the impact on councils varies. Now, that is linked to the way that the money is distributed. Obviously, we update the indicators that are influenced by things like population and the likes. And we do offer a degree of protection for councils so that they will not be as adversely impacted by movements in the indicators when it comes to their settlement, and that's where we have the floor that protects councils. So it's probably quite a sensitive area, but you know, I think we've got to look at local government funding in totality and work with individual councils who do have concerns to get behind why there are movements and what can be done.
Thank you, Eileen. And now we'll go to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I wanted to ask a couple of questions with regards to impact on council tax increases, because we know in the year before the pandemic, council tax debt increased by 25% to over £95 million. So I wondered, from the previous evidence which has been given with a suspected 3% increase in council tax, what impact assessment has been done on potential for people to be pushed into council tax debt by this budget? Maybe start with Gail, and if others want to come in, could you put an R in the chat, please?
Thanks, Miles. I think it would actually be better just to pass this to Martin or Eileen, because they will have been working on this more closely.
Great, thanks.
Don't know who wants to go first.
Eileen, would you like to come in on that?
Yes, so certainly we are seeing pressures on our debt collection around council tax already. So within Fife, we have, you know, a £1 million issue already. So that is clearly causing us a problem. And with the pressures on household expenditure, you know, with the likes of energy increases and the likes, you know, we expect that we will work more closely with households to encourage them to pay and put in place payment plans to assist them. Probably want to flag up that there's changes to council tax reduction coming in from April this year, and that, you know, the intention here is to actually provide more support to people who are requiring that support. When we moved from housing benefit to universal credit, there was a change in the kind of cohort of people who actually receive support, so that is trying to be addressed. But I do expect that this budget will continue to impact on that people paying their council tax, because I envisage that most councils will be looking at say a 3% increase. So that will increase pressures on households.
Thank you. And Martin, did you want to add anything to that question?
Again, I think Eileen's covered it. Again, our experience is that during COVID, we've had a reduction in our collection rates, a fairly marginal reduction, but still a reduction. And we're expecting that to recover, but putting council tax up will not help that position. And we will work very closely with households to support them as much as we can. But it is definitely a risk that we're very aware of.
Thank you for that. And my second question was with regards to how the councils are likely to push down on some of these cost pressures to therefore not increase council tax above inflation. And, you know, given the previous settlements have seen cuts to services, which areas are still there, do you think, for councils to look towards cutting, increasing charging or reducing service? And just wondered, you know, across Scotland, what that would look like. I may be ringing Martin, and if Gail or Aileen want to come in, can you put an R in the chat as well? Thanks.
Thank you. And yeah, it will be increasingly difficult to close those gaps after a number of years of austerity. There's not very many easy options left. We're looking across the board, and it's probably important to state at this moment, anything that I see here is kind of my opinion. These decisions will be taken by our elected members, and it's for them to make those final decisions. But we'll be looking at every single area of service delivery. The opportunity to increase charges is fairly limited, and again, quite often we're a provider of last resort. So the people that you would impact on the most are the people you'd like to impact on the least by charging. So that's a challenging area, but you know, there have already been moves where green spaces will be rewilded, i.e. there'll be less cuts to grass. Maintenance budgets for roads and pavements are likely to come under scrutiny. Some of the additional education services that we provide in Glasgow will definitely be under challenge. So Glasgow has over 100 different languages as a first language among its school population. So the support for English as a second language will undoubtedly come under challenge. Glasgow also has a specialist dyslexia unit that provides support to teachers with the number of children that suffer from dyslexia and other conditions like that. That specialist unit will come under pressure. Glasgow is also very proud of the impact that its nurture provision has had on educational attainment. But again, that additional resource, I think, will undoubtedly come under pressure as part of those budget decisions. I think we've already referred to the pressure on leisure and cultural services. At the moment, Glasgow hasn't reopened all of its venues since after COVID, and the ability to reopen all of those again will come under increasing pressure.
Thank you for that. Gail, you wanted to come in as well.
Yeah, just very briefly, Miles, thanks. I think it's really just to highlight the disproportionate percentage of cuts that we've had in certain areas of budget in recent years compared to others. So we've seen a sort of circa 22% increase in the education and social care budgets, which is absolutely fine and valid and has gone towards certain policy commitments. Within that, we've also seen a 17% reduction in roads and transport, a circa 8% reduction in culture and leisure, and around about a 5% in planning and building control and economic development. And I think what we're seeing is a disproportionate amount of cuts having to come from a very small part of the council to ensure that we can continue to deliver the ring-fenced overarching policies as well. And we saw that within the pandemic, that when businesses were reopening, we had a huge shortage of environmental health officers, and we needed to rally and suddenly put some additional funding into that particular budget to get more. So if we continue to erode our roads and transport, our planning, our building control, our backroom, our digital work, that has a disproportionate impact on those services and how we can deliver. And just finally, within the fiscal framework work, we are looking at seeking greater ability to raise planning fees and to look at building control fees. Very low hanging fruit, it's not going to bring in a fortune, but I think every little bit can help, and obviously we will work with government to sort of develop those areas as well.
Thank you. And just finally, in terms of the funding formula, which councils do you think are least able to meet that challenge? In my own area of Edinburgh, which receives the lowest funding per head of population, we know the pressures on social care, on housing, and with most of the delayed discharge problems NHS Scotland are facing actually being here in the capital. So I just wondered, from the discussions going on at a national level in COSLA, which councils are most likely to be leading to see the largest council tax increases, do you believe?
It's not information I have to hand. We could potentially provide the committee with that information.
That'd be helpful. Thanks very much. Thank you, Kamina.
Thank you, Miles. And I just want to say thank you to Councillor Gail McGregor, Eileen Rowand and Martin Booth for joining us this morning and providing us with very useful responses to our questions. We're now going to suspend to allow the witnesses to leave.
Thank you, Convener.
Welcome back, and we'll continue taking evidence as part of our budget scrutiny. I'd like to welcome our third and final panel this morning. That's Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy, Shona Robson, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, Caroline Dix, Investment Manager for the Scottish Government, Ellen Lever, Deputy Director of Local Government and Analytical Services Division, Katrina McKean, Head of Better Homes, and Ian Story, who's the Head of Local Government Finance at the Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us today. And witnesses, if you wish to respond or contribute to the discussion, please add an R to the chat box to indicate this. And before we get going with questions, I'd like to invite the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy, followed by Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, to give brief opening statements. Cabinet Secretaries.
Thank you, Convener, and it's good to be able to join you this morning. I appreciate that you've had a long session already this morning and that the Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery provided you with a detailed written response to a range of questions late last year, so I'll keep my opening comments fairly brief. I will start, however, with a comment that you won't have heard for the first time. But I do need to be very clear at the outset that this budget has been hugely challenging. The Scottish Fiscal Commission, which is obviously the key forecasting body, in their economic and fiscal forecast report states, and I quote, that overall the Scottish budget in 2022-23 is 2.6% lower than last year. After accounting for inflation, the reduction is 5.2%. And it's against that backdrop that we this morning discuss the local government budget. Our budget has had a laser-like focus on three key challenges: tackling child poverty, climate change, and economic recovery. And we endeavour in this budget to strike a balance to ensure parity of funding across sectors with limited resources. The budget published for next year confirmed that even in the face of significant economic uncertainty caused by the pandemic, we, amongst other things, are providing councils with a real terms increase to their overall budgets for the coming year of more than 5% for our shared priorities. Local authorities are key partners with government, and perhaps never more so than during the pandemic, as we tackled it together to protect communities, businesses and public services. And moving forward, they will quite clearly play an important leadership role. I recognise also, just one last brief comment, the importance of planning as part of this. And our transformation of the planning system will help to streamline the system and free up resources to enable good quality development that we'll need in the future. And to support that, we're bringing forward new fees regulations, which will help ensure that applicants rather than the taxpayer covers the cost of processing planning applications. And we're also investing in the digital transformation of the planning system. And I mention that because I know, Convener, that's been raised in the past. I'll stop now and hand over to my colleague, Shona Robison, to say more about the settlement in relation to her portfolio. Thank you.
Thank you. Shona Robison.
Thanks very much, Convener, and thanks to the committee for inviting me to speak to you today. I will be brief also. But just to reiterate what Kate Forbes has said, that the 2022-23 budget has been challenging and has been one of difficult decisions and choices. And the ones that we have taken should help lift children out of poverty, provide investment in social care and help tackle the climate emergency. Our budget for next year increases funding for affordable housing by £174 million, so we can continue the important work that was started back in 2007 and ensure that everyone in Scotland has a warm, safe and affordable place to live. We're allocating £831 million towards the delivery of 110,000 affordable homes by 2032, of which at least 70% will be available for social rent. 10% will be in our remote, rural and island communities. More than £80 million will be allocated to discretionary housing payments for housing support and to fully mitigate the UK government's bedroom tax. and we're making a further £10 million available for our Ending Homelessness Together Fund as part of our investment of £100 million transformation funding between 2018-19 and 2025-26. And finally, the 2022-23 budget provides our local authorities with a fair but affordable settlement of over £12.5 billion under the most challenging of circumstances. And that will provide £554 million extra for health and social care, £145 million for additional teachers and support staff, and £94 million to support the expansion of free school meals. And of course, it gives local authorities a number of fiscal flexibilities, including full autonomy on council tax rate setting as they requested, and a commitment to collaborate on a fiscal framework for local government. I look forward to your questions.
Thank you very much for that. I'm going to start off with questions, and I'm going to direct this one to Kate Forbes. I'm aware of the future plans to publish multi-year settlements, which is strongly welcome. But what else do you think the Scottish Government can do to help local authorities tackle long-term challenges and plan strategically?
It's probably one of the most pertinent questions right now, and the committee will know that alongside the budget that was published in December, we published our consultation for the spending review. And that spending review, as the convener has referenced, will provide certainty all parts of the public sector on what their budgets look like for the next 3 to 4 years. I'm conscious that when it comes to long-term reform, when it comes to prudent use of public finances, being able to plan on more than an annual basis is absolutely essential. We had already done that, taken steps to do that on a capital basis last year, but with the UK government spending review published on the 27th of October, we can now proceed. The key here too is that I want the consultation process to be as engaging as possible. So what I don't want is this to be a government document that's published without input from our partners. And I've already had a number of conversations with the Cause of Finance spokesperson, Gail McGregor, on how we can ensure, notwithstanding some of the challenges facing, or not challenges, but some of the uncertainties facing local government in light of changing personnel and administrations with elections and so on and so forth, how we ensure that over the next 6 months, we are engaging considerably with local government through my relationship with Gail McGregor. The other part to this, and I know it was referenced in the earlier panel, is the long-standing discussions about essentially a fiscal framework for local government. So we have been in discussion, as Gail said, about building a fiscal framework for local government. And so the letter that was published alongside the budget to COSLA confirms our commitment to undertake very intensive collaborative work on that fiscal framework for local government. It's unfortunate, but I think understandable, that a lot of time has been consumed by COVID, certainly on a local government level, with officers very consumed with that mission, and the same goes in the Scottish Government as well. But that intensive work, I hope, will allow for more flexibilities and for more empowerment for a local government to make decisions that are best suited to their local authority areas.
Thank you for that. And I'm just going to continue along that line a little bit. In the previous panel, I raised the question about the yearly recurring debate between COSLA and the Scottish Government, and I just would like to hear, and you've already kind of touched on your desire for more engagement, more collaboration, and Councillor McGregor was talking about the ideas that the policy is developed in consultation with COSLA and local authorities. And I'd just love to hear a little bit more, along those lines of other areas where consultation and collaboration could be carried out, and that's for Kate Forbes.
Thanks. So 2 points in response to that. The first is that prior to the publication of my budget this year or in previous years, there, I meet regularly, very regularly with Gail McGregor. There was probably, if I remember off the top of my head, three or four very intensive meetings in the immediate run-up to the budget. Obviously, I meet regularly more generally, but very intensive conversations with Gail to get a full understanding of the pressures facing local authorities, which I don't dispute that there are pressures, but also to understand our shared commitments. And you know, I think sometimes during these annual debates, as the convener has understandably put it, we lose sight of the fact that there is a lot of shared commitments between COSLA and the Scottish Government. And I say COSLA because obviously as the body representing all local authorities, each local authority will have slightly different nuances. The other thing that we have done this year, which is unusual, is that between Shona Robison and myself, we endeavoured over the course of the last essentially 2 months to meet with every single local authority, meet with chief exec and a local authority leader to make sure that we had a handle on their own local circumstances. So whilst COSLA will understandably and rightly present the sort of blanket approach from local authorities, we wanted to ensure that we understood what the challenges were facing each different local area. And that invitation went out to local authorities, and I can't recall precisely how many I've met and how many Shona Robison has met, but we have endeavoured both to get the high level view from COSLA as well as get into the detail for each local authority area. And you know, the challenges, say, facing Inverclyde are different to the challenges facing Moray, which are different again to the challenges facing Glasgow City. And so that conversation does hugely inform our budget. And a lot of the financial commitments, which perhaps are not taken into account in the annual debate about core budgets, but for example, the two areas that I am regularly hearing from local authorities individually and from COSLA would be the challenges around social care, which is why we've significantly increased funding on social care. And incidentally, I've tried to ensure that money, consequential funding for health and social care has gone to local authorities precisely because I know of the pressures that they have cited on social care. And the second one is on income inequalities, the fact that the pandemic has exacerbated challenges facing the most vulnerable in society, which is why we are rolling out free school meals in collaboration with local authorities. So I just cite these two examples, which I think, I don't want to speak for COSLA, but I think COSLA and individual local authorities would both agree there are important shared commitments, and that's why they have been prioritised as part of the overall local government settlement.
Thanks very much for that, Kate. Shona Robison, I don't know if you want to come in on either, you know, if you've got any responses to either my first question around supporting local authorities to tackle long-term challenges in planning, or this piece around what are the potential solutions for encouraging cooperation between COSLA and the Scottish Government.
Well, I think, as Kate Forbes says, there's good, a very close working relationship with COSLA. Like Kate, I meet COSLA, the COSLA leadership on a regular basis, but as Kate has also laid out, I've met, as she has, a number of individual local authority leaders and their chief executives, and that has been really useful to get in underneath some of the priorities. So affordable housing, a key priority for many, or most, nearly all, I would say, local authorities, but it's been one area that we've managed to discuss in those individual meetings, and in you know, a number of projects and potential collaborative working have emerged through those meetings. So I think that is helpful. Clearly, going forward, there will be a number of major pieces of work around the fiscal framework, around COVID recovery, which obviously is absolutely key, around tackling child poverty, which again there is a collaborative approach with COSLA, who are very, as I know, local government are very committed to working with us to tackle child poverty. So yes, the debates that we'll have around the quantum and the figures perhaps sometimes don't tell the full story of the work that is going on behind the scenes between ourselves and local government on the joint priorities that we share.
Thank you for that. I'm now going to bring in Megan Gallagher with a question.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to both Cabinet Secretaries. I've got a question for each Cabinet Secretary this morning. If I could start with Shona Robison, please. Councils are struggling to maintain vital services due to the level of cuts administered by the Scottish Government in recent years. We heard some examples earlier on of cuts councils have had to make in order to balance the books. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that it is due to the decisions taken by this government that local government budgets have been cut year in year, and this has led to councils being unable to provide for their communities? And I'm not talking about the government's key priorities, I'm talking about the basics such as education, bins and roads.
Well, I guess the first response I would give to Megan Gallagher is that, you know, the budget that the Scottish Government has is by and large the block grant received from the UK Government. And of course, we have seen years of austerity and difficult decisions following from that settlement in itself. So, you know, if you look at the comparison of funding north and south of the border, it's very clear that despite the challenges that absolutely Scottish local authorities face, it is absolutely in a completely different ballpark than the challenges and the cuts to local government funding that local authorities south of the border have faced. So going forward, we have a lot of joint priorities with local government. Megan Gallagher talked about the funding that is over and above the core settlement. But of course, those are our key joint priorities. Tackling child poverty is a key one, making sure that we are supporting education, supporting social care, and the money going into social care has increased considerably. So these are priorities that I hope would be shared across the Parliament. Difficult decisions have to be made, and I guess the final thing I would say to Megan Gallagher is that obviously as part of the budget discussion, it's open to parties to come forward with amendments and changes to the budget, but of course wanting money to be spent in one area of government requires that party to see where that money should come from, and you know, I'm sure we'll get into some of those detailed discussions over the next few weeks.
Thank you for your answer, Cabinet Secretary. And I've got a question for Kate Forbes as well. Council leaders have written to the First Minister to request a meeting to discuss the budget settlement. As we heard from Councillor Gail McGregor earlier on, the First Minister has declined this request. If the Scottish Government is confident in their defence of the local government settlement, why would the First Minister decline such a meeting with council leaders?
Well, I think my answer would be that she hasn't, and perhaps rather than me making disputing the characterisation of the letter, it would be easier for me to share our letter of response with the committee so that the committee can read that letter. The letter states quite clearly, and this is written by me in response to the letter I received. We were the local government leaders wrote both to myself and to the First Minister. I have responded, as I have responsibility for local government finance, and I said that I was very much looking forward to meeting with the COSLA presidential team. I believe on the 20th of January, if I've got that date wrong, I will correct the record, but I'm happy if it's permitted to share that letter of response with the committee.
That would be useful if you could, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Megan. And I'd now like to bring in Eleanor Whittam.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to both Cabinet Secretaries. I know this has already been touched on, but given its significant importance, I want to raise it again. Given that this budget year has been particularly difficult for the Scottish Government in relation to the cut that we're experiencing to the block grant in real terms, and if we can think of the £2.6 billion in resource budget alone, can the Cabinet Secretaries explain how the Scottish Government has focused on shared priorities with local government, such as lifting children out of poverty, building more affordable homes, investing in social care, tackling the climate emergency, and how the VAST in-year transfers from other portfolios will help to deliver on these critical shared priorities, and how for some of them, we're going to have to actually look at them in terms of the whole parliamentary term and not a single year. And here specifically, I'm thinking about housing. So I don't know whether we want to start with yourself, Ms. Forbes, and then perhaps if Ms. Robinson wants to come in specifically around about housing.
Yes, I'm happy to come in, and I appreciate, you know, again, I've said it when I've been in front of a committee before, but I appreciate that there's a lot of experience and expertise around this committee in particular when it comes to local government. And Elena Whittam in particular has extensive experience of local government. If I take a brief step back from the question and say that as a result of the challenges in this budget, I don't think anybody actually disputes that it is a hugely challenging overall budget. In light of those challenges, I made a conscious decision to identify three priorities that we could really get behind and we could focus on and maximise our effort in dealing with. And those were, as I said in my opening remarks, tackling child poverty, because we know that the pandemic has had a hugely detrimental impact on some of the most vulnerable in society. Secondly, continuing to tackle COVID, because COVID is still quite clearly with us, despite the fact that there was no COVID consequentials. So tackling COVID and economic recovery go hand in hand. And then the last point is on climate change and on helping us to shift it when it comes to our investments. And therefore, where does the local government budget come in? Well, we can't achieve any of those three aims without local government. Of that, there is no question, there's no doubt. Local government are not just a valued partner rhetorically. I engage with them, rely on them, work with them on probably a daily basis. Certainly my teams do. And so the budget that you see before you in terms of the local government settlement, it could be categorised in two ways. The first is that there's a protection for the core budget in cash terms. Now, I understand that the inflation is having a significant impact on all budget lines, and I can't inflation proof any budget line because my overall budget that I receive is not inflation proof. So I can't inflation proof when inflation is running at 5% or more. But we have protected the core budget in cash terms. And then the second part is the real terms growth to the overall settlement. And that, you know, I've already referenced some things, but if I just mention some again just now, £68.2 million for child bridging payments, an additional £64 million of resource, £30 million of capital to facilitate the expansion of free school meals, £353.9 million of funding for health and social care integration, and £200 million on top of that from health and social care consequentials. So these are all dealing with those three big objectives. And you know, I think local government would fairly identify the fact that education is part of their core remit. So providing additional support for teachers, social care is part of their core remit. So providing additional support for social care does help. But I don't dispute, and I will never dispute, that these are challenging times. And I have huge respect for local government leaders who have to, in the same way that I have to, make difficult decisions in order to reach a balanced position and invest in their priorities.
Thank you very much. And could we perhaps hear from Shona Robinson in terms of housing and looking at it over the longer parliamentary term as opposed to just a single year?
Yes, I mean, the affordable housing budget, as I set out in my opening remarks, is increasing by £174 million. That's broken down with £40 million on the previous published capital spending review figure and an increase of £134 million in financial transactions, so £174 million increase. And that brings the total now available for affordable housing across this parliamentary term. It increases it from £3.444 billion to £3.618 billion. So that's a 21% increase compared to the previous 5 years. And of course, that will always be phased across the 5 years in slight, you know, differing from year to year. What's important is the quantum across the 5 years. Now, We're well aware of some of the pressures on that. We know that there's ongoing market condition pressures facing the construction sector, and that's why there's going to be a targeted review of the Scottish Government's capital spending review in early 2022, alongside the resource spending review, and that will be important. So we need to make sure that that investment delivers the affordable housing across Scotland that we know is so badly needed, and it will go a long way towards doing that.
Thank you very much for your answer there, Ms. Robson. Finally from me, another question again to Kate Forbes, and I know that you have already touched on this, and Councillor Gail McGregor was quite clear as well on her position on it. Now we know that we've looked for some fiscal flexibility, and it's been given in terms of removing the cap from council tax. And there's a lot of discussion round about this fiscal framework. And indeed, Gail McGregor mentioned the negotiations between the Scottish Government and the UK Government in terms of reworking that whole agreement going forward. So just a couple of words, to reiterate how important that fiscal framework is going to be and how quickly we can expect that to be agreed. Thank you.
It's hugely important. It's one of my top priorities. I would like to see this completed as a matter of urgency, so that local government, COSLA and ourselves are happy with that. You will also know that we have committed to a citizens' assembly on sources of local government funding, so looking at taxation as well, so work has begun to prepare for that citizens' assembly. But in terms of the importance of it, it's hugely important.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Back to yourself, Convener.
Thanks very much, Eleanor. I'm just going to take a little dive up north and ask a bit of a question that I already asked in the previous panel around the three local island authorities. So I'd like to address this to you, Kate Forbes. So I'm curious to know, why are the three island local authorities, the sole authorities, a real terms reduction in their overall revenue allocations in 2022-23, given the unique pressures they face and the historic being historically underfunded for the additional services that they manage, ferries, for example?
Yes, thanks. And I should say that actually 2 years ago, if I remember correctly, was one of the first times where I intentionally ensured that there was additional funding specifically for ferries in the local government settlement, in additional money for ferries in the local government settlement, which I know was warmly welcomed, particularly by the Northern Isles. But the local government settlement is distributed in full, as you'll know, using a needs-based formula, and that is discussed and it's agreed each year with COSLA on behalf of quite clearly all 32 local authority members. And so, you know, when it comes to the island specifically, they also, as part of the overall methodology, receive a special island needs allowance. And they also, the methodology recognises, and I think I heard one of your previous panel members touching on this, that there's additional funding embedded in the methodology to help meet the additional costs of providing services in island communities. And so combining the fact that that's referenced within the core methodology and also in the Special Islands Needs Allowance, there is additional funding in the process, as it were, recognise those additional needs. I will say, though, that I am open to any review of the methodology, any changes to the methodology, I am open to. That would need to be a request by COSLA. It's not something I would want to impose on COSLA. But if there was to be a request from COSLA to review the methodology, if, for example, some local authorities feel like the methodology does not take into account their particular unique circumstances, then I would be very open to an intensive piece of work to review the methodology.
Thank you very much for your response. And I'm now going to move to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to both Cabinet Secretaries. And on the previous question, I think that's a welcome move, because for too long, many councils, including my own in Edinburgh, have been expressing concern that they are the lowest funded council, but also we have the lowest funded health board. So I would just say to the Cabinet Secretary, I hope both will be looked at, not just council funding. But I wanted to ask a specific question with regards to council tax increases, specifically to the Cabinet Secretary, Kate Forbes. What would you see as the likely average level of council tax increase we're likely to see councils have to set following your budget?
Well, I'm going to resist answering that question directly for one very good reason, which I will unpack, and that is that local authorities have long asked for flexible and discretionary tax setting powers. So for me to now say that this is what I expect of them, I think would run the risk of undermining that position. But like I have to take or make tax decisions that reflect the particular challenges facing households, that reflect our particular budget needs, I would expect local authorities to do likewise, taking into account some of the burdens on households right now, but also the need to fund local services. And Miles Briggs will know that for years, perhaps for 14 years, although neither he nor I have been here for 14 years, local authorities have been requesting that discretion to set council tax, and they are able to do so this year. As a result of that freeze that we had for a number of years, of course, you'll also know that on average, council tax bills at Band D are significantly lower in Scotland than they are in England and Wales. But quite clearly, it's a challenging time for households.
Thank you for that. So I think reading between the lines, the 3% increase, the inflation increase, nothing above that is what Cosler outlined previously in the previous session would be probably expected. That's your expectation as well, then, I take it.
Well, I'm going to resist making any expectations, because it does completely fly in the face of the whole point of setting a discretion. But on average, about 1% of a council tax increase raises about £30 million. So 3% is about £90 million. That's certainly how we funded the freeze last year. So that's the kind of ballpark figure you're talking about by referencing 3%.
Okay, thank you for that answer. I think all of us as MSPs will be acutely aware of the cost of living crisis, especially around increases in energy costs. So I think for many people, seeing a potential significant increase in council tax is going to hit them hard. And so I wanted to ask what work has been undertaken to look at any impact assessment on this? I know the Cabinet Secretary, Shona Robson, has been at other committees in this parliament saying that the council tax element of people's outgoings is actually one of the hardest taxes for people to pay. So what impact assessment has taken place, and what extent is this going to push more people into poverty in Scotland if we see above inflation increases? So I'll maybe bring in Shona Robson and then the Cabinet Secretary, Kate Forbes, after that.
Well, I mean, obviously, I think the first thing to say is that thankfully, the council tax is lower in Scotland than elsewhere, which is helpful. And of course, importantly, that Miles Briggs will be aware of, the council tax reduction scheme is there to ensure that no one has to pay a council tax liability that they can't be expected to afford. And presently, around 480,000 households, or nearly one in five, benefits from a council tax reduction. And that's going to be really important. The local government budget includes £351 million to compensate councils for the reduction in council tax receipts derived from the operation of council tax reduction scheme. So, I mean, I think taken as a basket of measures supporting families across all of the other things outlined, whether that's the discretionary housing payments, whether it's the Scottish Welfare Fund, whether it's the benefits and supports paid through Social Security Scotland, I think this government has a good track record, the Scottish Child Payment being one that is critical, and obviously our commitment to doubling that I think as a basket of measures to support families, I think taken in the round, that those are available here that are in Scotland that are not available anywhere else in these islands.
Before I bring in Kate Forbes, that basket of measures has resulted in a 25% increase in council tax debt to over £95 million. So it's clear that those who are least able to pay the council tax are actually having these arrears, and councils are reporting that. So what else will be taking place within government to look at this? Because it's quite clear that the cost of living will impact on those least likely to be able to pay this council tax increase, especially if it's above inflation. And many councils potentially could see way above inflation council tax increases.
Well, look, I think the whole cost of living issue is something that all governments will need to look at. But if you look at, for example, the rise in energy costs and food costs at the moment, and we've been calling on the UK government to be far more proactive in tackling the issue of rising energy costs. So the cost of living pressures are across the whole of household income and expenditure. And of course, the Scottish Government does have a responsibility to try and support families as best we can. And I've outlined in my previous answer some of the ways that we're doing that, whether that's through the Welfare Fund, discretionary housing payments, Scottish Child Payment, the winter package that we announced, the £41 million, which was to support families with pressures around food and fuel costs, around household income pressures. So I think our government does have a good track record on supporting families. Obviously, we need to look at what more we can do, and I'm always open to having those discussions about how we support families. I think the next few months, particularly around energy costs, are going to be really, really, really challenging. And that can't just be the Scottish Government response to that. We need to see more coming from the UK Government to support families and household incomes as well.
Thank you. And can I bring in Kate Forbes?
Thanks. You know, two parts to this answer. The first is that, remember, whilst I don't want to constantly compare households north and south of the border, I think it's important because it's coming from the same overall settlement because of the Barnett formula. And you know, Shona Robinson has already said that council tax is lower in Scotland than elsewhere. Remember that last year, on average, council tax went up very significantly in England after a number of years of rising. Whereas in Scotland, there hasn't been that compounding effect of an increase last year. So that is precisely why, on average, Band D charges in Scotland are about £590 more in England and £423 more in Wales than in Scotland. But in terms of what we are doing, I think in your previous panel, they alluded to the fact that we have, from April, reformed the council tax reduction scheme. £351 million will be baselined within the local government budget for the policy costs, but we've changed it in order to ensure that we don't miss people as a result of changes to universal credit. So in other words, we are trying to ensure that as many eligible households are covered as possible. And for the last few years, and certainly for the last 5 years, the amount of money that we've provided to cover council tax reduction schemes has been higher than the demand. So there's been headroom for local government to manage that. The last point I would make, though, is that I don't think you can look at council tax arrears in isolation. Challenges in paying council tax are part of a challenging financial situation for households. So you can't look at council tax reduction, for example, in isolation of our wider budget commitments. You know, there's £197 million in my budget to double the Scottish Child Payment and extend it to under 16s. Shona Robinson has taken forward a huge amount of work over the last few months to provide additional support to households. So I think you need to look at the wider support, and without getting too political, you know, a lot of that is compensating for a welfare system and a welfare system that is not helping families where they need to be helped, and removing £20 a week from these households are not going to help. It's not going to help with them paying their council tax.
Thank you. And just finally, and with respect, you know, it's SNP councillors who are speaking out against this current proposed budget and the letter they've sent to the First Minister. It's not just ourselves. It's clear that SNP Council leaders are not content with the budget you've put forward. Now, in terms of the Barnett consequentials, would you accept that as a percentage, local government's not receiving the full allocation it should? In fact, £371 million should be additionally being provided to local government in Scotland.
I would question what the basis for your figures are, because those are not figures that I recognise. If I go back to my opening comment, in fact, don't use my words, use the Scottish Fiscal Commission. They have said that the overall Scottish budget is 2.6% lower next year than it is this year. And if you account for inflation, then the reduction is 5.2%. And at the same time, I have protected in cash terms the local government core budget, as well as delivered a 5% increase to the overall settlement. So I would question your figures as not perhaps being entirely consistent with what the Scottish Fiscal Commission is saying.
Well, they're not my figures, they're COSLA's figures, and they've specifically said that this is a £371 million cut to councils across Scotland, and that was what all the SNP councillors have signed that letter to the First Minister complaining about.
So I think where I was disputing your comments was the fact that that our budget settlement allows for inflation-proofing all budgets. It doesn't. Our budget, our overall quantum, does not allow us to inflation-proof all budgets. And in terms of that £371 million that COSLA are citing, that is taking into account the impact of inflation. And you know, I'm quite open and upfront that I can't inflation-proof all budgets. So you know, in terms of the overall quantum we've received, which obviously has been stripped of all COVID consequentials, it's not been inflation proofed. We have tried to be as fair as possible in distributing that funding. And you know, I guess I'd go back to Shona Robinson's point that if you think that there are areas which should be increased, which is a perfectly legitimate position to take, then I would need to know where it comes from, because I have maximised the spending power within the budget for next year.
And just finally, convener, before I hand back to you, if that's the case, where did the additional £100 million come from, which was found beyond the budget you announced to Parliament?
I'm assuming that you're talking about for Omicron business support.
Yes. Yeah.
That is this year's budget, which is fundamentally different from next year's budget.
And that was within what allocation then?
Well, it's more than that. But we have announced £375 million. You'll know that a lot of that's from UK government, and £200 million from within our own budgets. That comes from a number of different sources. I think the First Minister has set out already that some of that is from the health portfolio in terms of consequentials that were received earlier in the year. And it also comes from a requirement from every portfolio, as it were, to contribute towards these costs. Every portfolio is now managing budget pressures in order to get to a position of balance this year. But I would also cite the fact that in previous budgets, some of the funding for the next year has been based on carry forward. So, for example, coming towards the end of the financial year, looking ahead and identifying where there might be late money, for example, that we can carry forward. There is no forecast headroom in this year's budget at all, which can be carried forward into next year's budget. So from that perspective, it's quite an unusual year, and it illustrates just how challenging next year's budget is. And this year's budget, the fact that there has not been funding identified which we can carry forward. One really brief last point that I would make is one of the advantages, obviously, of having an early budget is that we can give more certainty to taxpayers, to local authorities and so on. One of the drawbacks is that the later you are in the financial year, the more certainty you have of where you will land in this financial year. So because we're doing it so early, we're basing it on forecasts at this stage, which is to say that there's no headroom available this year to carry forward into next year. Now, you know, if there are late consequentials, and we expect the supplementary estimates to be over the course of the next few weeks from the UK government when they finalise what this year's budget looks like, if there's anything available in that, then we will either need to use it for pressures this year, or there might be something we can do into next year, but that will be quite late on in the process.
Okay, thank you, convener.
Thank you, Miles. And now we'll move to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to both Cabinet Secretaries. First point I'd like to make, I think the COSLA spokesperson just earlier was gracious enough to acknowledge and recognise the overall settlement being £12.5 billion, a real terms increase of £600 million, which is equivalent to a 5% increase. She was gracious enough to recognise that, and there's been a whole lot of debate around that during the session. But my first question to you, Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes, is it's on the methodology again, if you don't mind, which was discussed earlier too. My good friend and colleague Miles Briggs said Edinburgh is hard done by the settlement, but if you look at the percentage uplifts that some of the local authorities are receiving, Edinburgh is getting more of an uplift than, for example, East Ayrshire, Inverclyde, Glasgow and Dundee. Now, is one of the factors in the methodology, Cabinet Secretary, population, so that if an authority loses substantial numbers of its population, then its overall allocation diminishes. Do you recognise, though, that those local authorities still have to deliver, by and large, the same level of service to a diminishing number of population, but it's still very difficult for them to do that? And is that something that you might look at in any further review of the model that we have in place for awarding the cash to local government?
Thanks to Willie Coffey. I think that the methodology does take into account population amongst many other things, and I may bring in Ian Storey straight after this to talk more about what the methodology includes and what it doesn't include. But I go back to the comment I made in response to a previous questioner, which was that I am very open to reviewing the methodology. And I think every local authority has unique circumstances. So the Highlands, where I'm a resident, may have fewer people, but has a lot more miles of road that need to be maintained. Quite clearly in Edinburgh, there may be a higher population, but different challenges. And again, in Ayrshire, there will be their own unique challenges. And the methodology is hugely complex because it tries to take into account all of these unique circumstances. And as I said, for the islands, over and above the methodology, then have special allowances. So the methodology endeavours to do that, but I'm not beholden to that methodology. If there was an appetite for reviewing it, then I've already had conversations with some local authorities who are seeing, for example, exponential population growth or exponential population decline, and ensuring that the methodology takes into account that. But if the convener doesn't mind, Ian Storey might want to say more on what the methodology includes and doesn't include.
Yes, absolutely. Welcome, Ian, to speak to this. Yeah.
Thank you. And I don't have a great deal to add to Ms. Forbes' comprehensive summary. The distribution formula is a hugely complex distribution formula. It has 73 pages of tables that actually include things like road length, teacher numbers, flood management, building control, waste disposal, and all of these different factors are then weighted into the distribution formula on a council by council basis. And for each additional spending line, that will be considered by a joint group through the settlement and distribution group, which is a joint group between Scottish Government and local authorities and directors of finance in COSLA, where they consider all additional spending lines and what is the most appropriate methodology to distribute that individual funding line. So, for example, in the recent teacher numbers, it was on pupil numbers with a weighting added for deprivation. So that individual spending line is given its own distribution formula, which is then factored in. And if you take that across all of the individual service levels, you get this really huge, complex formula. And all decisions by the settlement and distribution group are then endorsed by COSLA leaders. So ultimately, as Ms. Forbes said, this is jointly agreed with COSLA, and it would be quite difficult for Scottish Government to impose a different distribution formula without a specific review and request from COSLA themselves.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a point worth making here to have that discussion, Convener. But by any stretch of the imagination, I mean, authorities like East Ayrshire or Inverclyde or Dundee or Glasgow, where poverty and inequality is probably much higher than some of the other authorities, getting a bigger award, a bigger settlement, it surely has to call that into question, whether the modelling is weighted correctly, appropriately for circumstances like that. So I would leave that particular question to a future discussion, convener, and ask my second question, if I may, to Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes. We heard in the previous session Unison representative saying that the budget does nothing to tackle inequalities in Scotland. Could you give us a direct response to this and outline for the committee how the budget actually does tackle poverty and inequality?
Tackling poverty and inequality is one of the three top priorities in this budget. In fact, such is our commitment and effort to tackle poverty and inequalities that we have perhaps not funded other things in order to maximise the support to tackling child poverty in particular, but tackling poverty and inequalities. Shona Robison will be able to speak at length about the commitments in her portfolio, and I can speak about the funding that backs that up in order to ensure that we are tackling poverty and inequality. And local government are the most critical partners when it comes to doing that, whether it's in terms of its support in education, whether it's free school meals, whether it's doubling the Scottish Child Payment. You know, these are all financial commitments that I am choosing, that we as a government are choosing to make. And in so doing, it means there's less funding for other things, but that is the right decision to make because of our commitment to end the scourge of poverty in Scotland. Mona Robison is probably better equipped, as it's her portfolio, to speak about the policy commitments.
Thank you. Shona?
Thanks. I mean, just in addition, obviously, to reiterate what Kate Forbes has said, I mean, there is a huge amount within this budget that is aimed at COVID recovery, supporting household budgets, tackling poverty, and that has meant that difficult decisions have been made because you just can't fund everything. The budget provides for the continuation of child bridging payments in advance of the doubling of the Scottish Child Payment by the end of this year. It does other things like the scrapping of curriculum and music tuition charges, which help low-income families, the expansion of the school clothing grant, extra £64 million of revenue and £30 million of capital funding to support the expansion of free school meals. As I said in my opening remarks, the more than £80 million being allocated to discretionary housing payments for housing support, and of course that is to fully mitigate the UK government bedroom tax. If we didn't have to use it to mitigate the bedroom tax, if the bedroom tax was scrapped at source, which we have been urging the UK government to do, then we could divert that money to other anti-poverty measures. But meanwhile, we have to maintain that. We're making a further £10 million available for our ending homelessness strategy to tackle homelessness. And of course, the housing budget in itself is an anti-poverty measure. Good, affordable, quality housing is absolutely key. It's a key anti-poverty driver, and being able to increase the funding by £174 million against a backdrop of a really tough budget has been extremely important. And it's also an important economic lever as well, making sure that we can support local economies through that house building programme. So in the round, I think it absolutely does try to focus on supporting household incomes and on local incomes at a very, very difficult time indeed.
Thank you both for that. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Willie, for your questions. We're going to move on to questions from Paul McLennan, followed by questions from Mark Griffin. Paul.
Thank you, convener. Yeah, thank you, convener, and I'm saying good afternoon now, Cabinet Secretaries. Really, just to touch on the ongoing impact of the COVID pandemic, and Kate, I think you mentioned around about obviously the discussion about COVID consequentials, and all that's been raised by both Shona Robinson and the Deputy First Minister as well. I'm just wondering what the progress has been made in discussions with the UK government. This was also raised this morning by both COSLA and Unison, and if we have an estimate how much that's impacted on the budget, the forthcoming budget this year.
Yeah, so I have another meeting with my counterpart in the UK government over in the next few weeks. In fact, it might be this week. I think it is this week. Apologies. It's been brought forward because of Omicron, and again, that's one of the most frequent issues raised in my agenda with the UK government. So I will again be talking about the need to cover COVID consequentials. I mean, in every budget, I don't think there's any budgets that I can think of off the top of my head that have been immune to the impact of COVID. So whether it's justice remobilisation, whether it's the hospitals and the wider social care services that need to be remobilised, COVID has an impact right across the board. And yet we will have a budget. We have a budget where COVID consequentials have been stripped out. So over the last 2 years, that's amounted to about £14 billion. Last year, it was about £4 billion, and that won't be available. But we still need to absorb the costs of COVID, because you can't wish COVID away. So what that means is that COVID is quite clearly a priority. So we have got to, quite rightly, meet the costs of COVID, but it does put pressure on other things that we might want to do. So that's probably how I would frame it. One of the last things that I did in the last financial year, in fact, just before PIRDA started, was to allocate an additional £275 million of COVID consequentials to local government. And that was over and above £259 million, if memory serves, of COVID consequentials in the settlement for local government. There was quite a considerable amount of funding that was allocated to help local authorities with COVID pressures, but those were quite clearly one-off COVID consequentials, in the same way that the COVID consequentials from us is one-off, which makes it harder for local government in the same way as it makes it harder for us to deal with the ongoing costs of COVID without the additional funding available to deal with COVID.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. And now we've got a question from Mark Griffin.
Thank you, convener. Given how heroically local government staff have performed throughout the pandemic, how frustrated they've been at not receiving a pandemic bonus payment or a pay increase at a similar level to NHS staff, can I ask Cabinet Secretaries if they feel local government staff deserve an inflationary pay rise this year to cover the increasing cost of living?
Is that directed at me? Will I answer that one?
You go ahead, Kate, and then I think Mark wanted Shona to respond as well.
Okay. So on pay, we've obviously set out our public sector pay policy. And again, I've been open with the unions that I can't inflation-proof all elements of the public sector pay policy. So I'm being quite upfront and open that I can't inflation-proof. What we've chosen to prioritise is those at the lowest paid, to ensure that those policies are inflation proofed. Obviously, pay, and I've responded to Mark Griffin a number of times on this point, pay is a matter for local government. Pay for local government employees is a matter for local authorities. They are responsible for managing their own budgets, and pay for local government staff will be negotiated between the trade unions, GMB, Unison and Unite, and COSLA through the Scottish Joint Committee. I do think that local government employees have responded heroically. I've seen their work day in, day out, distributing welfare payments or distributing business support grants or being on the front line. They have responded heroically. I would like a scenario where all key workers are recompensed and rewarded for the work that they do, but where I have responsibility, which is in our public sector pay policy, which is obviously not applicable to local government, we have set out our own policy choices.
I think I don't really have much to add to what Kate Forbes has said, other than to add my comments and put on the record that we do absolutely appreciate and recognise the extraordinary efforts of council workers and the role that they've played in the fight against the pandemic. Absolutely, as have so many across the public sector. But as Kate Forbes has said, we are not a member of the SJC in terms of the negotiation on pay. And, you know, those are matters for local authorities to take forward.
Thanks for those answers. Both Cabinet Secretaries, if we were watching earlier evidence panels, will have heard from Unison representative about the surveys they've done of their members, of the consultative ballots that they had last year. And I guess in your own constituencies, just talking to local government workers themselves about how undervalued they feel, essentially how angry they feel at the amount of work they've done and a failure to be rewarded from that. And there was a very real prospect of strike action disrupting public services last year, which was averted at the 11th hour by the government providing additional funding to make a more generous pay offer. We've heard from COSA, who have said that making an inflationary pay award wouldn't be possible within this budget with a flat cash settlement for the core budget. What would the Cabinet Secretary say in response to the prospect of industrial action this year on top of the disruption that we've already seen because of the pandemic? I know myself from disruption to nursery and primary school education. What would you say regarding the prospect of strike action and the possible impact that would have on public services because of a breakdown and a lack of feeling valued by public sector, local government, public sector workers through an inadequate pay offer?
I mean, I start off an answer, I'll hand over to Kate after. I mean, obviously, we would want to avoid strike action, and we would hope that the unions and local government, COSLA, will continue to discuss pay and that strike action will be avoided. At the end of the £30 million that I think Mark Griffin was referring to, that I was able to find in my budget. It was difficult to find, but we found it was obviously a one-off payment to support COSLA in their pay negotiations for the for this financial year. It wasn't baselined into next year. So yeah, I mean, I absolutely appreciate what Mark Griffin has said. I hope that strike action will. We won't see that, and that we can avoid that, and that the pay discussions will continue and will come to an amicable resolution.
Yeah, I mean, I would just add very briefly to echo Shona Robson's comments that it's in nobody's industrial action is in nobody's interest, and there's obviously a process there of negotiation. Through the Scottish Joint Committee, and we're not members of it. I engage regularly with Gail McGregor as a finance spokesperson in terms of financial challenges and budgetary conditions, but ultimately that's a matter for negotiation between COSLA and the unions.
Thanks, Camina.
Thank you, Mark. I think we've come to the end of our questions, so just would like to thank Shona Robson and Kate Forbes for joining us this morning and responding to our questions. And as agreed earlier in the meeting, we'll consider items 3 and 4 in private. I now close the public part of the meeting and we will move into private.